New Manhattan. That's what this fellow told me on this website, and I saw a picture of the building, and it was. Now, they may have moved since then. Karl Marx, though, in his plank number 6, said you need government ownership of transportation. Did you know? Oh, we could go for 2 days on this one. I'm going to just touch it and go, and you're going to have 1,000 questions after this, right? When a car is manufactured, it gets a certificate of origin, or a manufacturer's certificate of origin, MSO. When it's brought into the state keeps that MSO in their files and issues a certificate of title. And so when you buy a new car, you don't really own the car. The state owns the car. You have to pay every year to keep a license plate on that car, don't you? But if you pay for the car from the dealer and you pay for it with gold or silver, real money, then you can get the manufacturer certificate of origin, MSO, and now you don't ever need license plates. Because you really actually own the car. That's another long, interesting story. Enough said. Do some research. You'll find out I'm telling the truth. Okay. Number 7, government ownership of factories and agriculture. Number 8, government control of labor. Number 9, corporate farms and regional planning. Number 10, free education. Did you know the free public school idea was Karl Marx's plan? Huh. Hitler said, you let me control the textbooks, I'll control the state. Now, the public schools in America had some really good Christian roots. Here's a primer used in public schools, home schools, parochial schools, until the 1900s. This is a first grade textbook. Look what they tell them. In Adam's fall, we sinned all. By the way, they used to make the letter S to look like an F, okay? Heaven to find, the Bible mind. Christ crucified, for sinners died. The deluge drowned the earth around. Did you know the public schools taught Christianity for a long time? Here's lessons for youth using the alphabet. A wise son maketh a glad father. B, better is a little with the fear of the Lord than great treasure and trouble therewith. C, come unto Christ, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. Don't you wish kids would learn the alphabet that way today in public school? United Nations, World Declaration on Education for All, called for all the nations of the world to adopt a common education system complete with implementation timetables and recommended curriculum. In our own nation, Goals 2000, School to Work, and the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, Profiles of Learning, now before Congress, are totally consistent with the One World Government recommendations of the UN Declaration. One of the guys in the Humanist magazine said, the battle for humankind's future must be waged and won in the public school classroom by teachers who correctly perceive their role as proselytizers of a new faith which will replace the rotting corpse of Christianity. This guy said, every child who enters school at age 5 is mentally ill because he comes to school with allegiance toward our elected officials, founding fathers, institutions, government, patriotism, nationalism, sovereignty. All these prove the child is sick because the well individual is one who has rejected all those things and is what I call the true international child of the future. Read that, communist, okay? This is a social studies book by HBJ, Harcourt Brace Jovanovich. It said, any child who believes in God is mentally ill. Humanist magazine ran this article in 1930. It said, education is the most powerful ally of humanism, and every American public school is a school of humanism. What can the theistic Sunday school, meeting once an hour once a week, and the teaching only a fraction of the children, do to stem the tide of a 5-day program of humanistic teaching? Good point. That's why we're losing them, folks. And some of you parents ought to go home and shut off that TV and study the Bible with your kids. As a matter of fact, this guy said creationism should be discriminated against. No advocate of such propaganda should be trusted to teach science classes or administer science programs anywhere under any circumstances. If they are doing so, they should be dismissed. Fire anybody who believes or teaches creation. An Iowa professor said, you should fail any student, no matter what the grade records indicate, if the professor discovers the student is a creationist. Furthermore, students' department should have the right of retracting grades and possibly even degrees if the student becomes a creationist later. Boy, he's real open-minded about this whole thing, isn't he? Mr. Yefremov lives in Pensacola, Florida. He's from Ukraine. He has 5 children. His oldest daughter is married to Bill, who's in charge of our maintenance department and our ministry, a lot of our ministry activities there. Her name is Ruth. She translated my material into Russian. His son David did a lot of video editing. He worked with me for years before he went full-time with UPS. Mr. Yefremov came to my house one day. He speaks broken English. And he laid his high school diploma on my desk. He said, "Dr. Hovind, I got my high school diploma." I thought, okay, you're, 55 years old? You have 5 kids, 3 of them grown in college. Why are you handing me your high school diploma? He said, "Oh, you must look at my report card." He showed me his Russian report card. You know, I couldn't read it, but he said, "This means A," and he had almost all A's and B's. I said, "Okay, yeah." He said, "Mr. Hovind, you don't understand. They just sent me my diploma 35 years later." I said, "Why?" He said, "When I was in high school in Russia, I took a test before I graduated. One of the questions on the test was, 'Do you believe in evolution?' I said, 'No.' They refused to let me graduate." Mr. Yefremov did the voiceover when we put my tapes into Russian, the first tape. We've redone it since then. But our first Russian tape was Mr. Yefremov speaking Russian while I'm up there standing, moving my lips, you know. That tape was sent to his hometown. The mayor watched it and said, "Wow, the whole city council needs to see this." They had a city council meeting and they watched my seminar in Russian. The guy who had refused to give him the diploma 35 years ago was now a city council member. And the mayor said, "Oh, Eugene Yefremov went to America and made it big. Look, he's a movie star. Hey, send him his diploma." Interesting story. You ought to read The Fourth Reich of the Rich to see how a lot of this ties together. John D. Rockefeller was very influential in using his money to ensure that the American school system became communistic, humanistic. Okay? Now listen, folks, I love my country, but I fear my government. And you better too. Here are the communist rules for revolution. Rule number 1, corrupt the young, get them away from religion. Rule number 2, break down the moral virtues. Rule number 3, encourage a soft government attitude toward crime. Number 4, divide the people into hostile groups. Number 5, get the people's minds off their government. Focus their attention on athletics or sex. Did you know in 1896 there were only 311 athletes in the Olympics? 100 years later, there were 13,000 athletes in the Olympics. How many channels on TV now are devoted to athletics? How much money is spent in America on sports? If you consider all things involved, transportation to and from, buying the property, building the buildings. Folks, it's many, many, many billions and billions of dollars. So somebody can knock a ball into a hole in the dirt. Athletics has taken over our thinking process. Here's an advertisement for a 50-inch TV. It says, "Football is a religion. Build a nice church." Rule number 6, get control of all the media, like CNN, the Communist News Network. Rockefeller, international billionaire, humanist, CFR kingpin, and founder of the Trilateralist Commission, world order godfather, and in all probability, the high school graduate voted most likely to be hanged for treason, voiced his praise of the controlled U.S. media for keeping their oath not to divulge the globalist plans to the public. Speaking to his fellow conspirators at a meeting in 1991 in Baden, Germany, one of the more infamous world order group, the Bilderbergers, Rockefeller said, "We are grateful to the Washington Post, the New York Times, Time Magazine, and other great publications whose directors have attended our meetings and respected their promises of discretion for almost 40 years. In other words, they're having these meetings to determine world events. The news media is there, but they don't report to us what really goes on in those meetings. because the average person shouldn't know what these guys are planning. They're making plans for a one-world government. He went on to explain, it would have been impossible for us to develop our plan for the world if we had been subjected to the lights of publicity during those years. But the world is now more sophisticated and prepared to march toward a world government. The supranational, that means above the national sovereignty, of an intellectual elite and world bankers is surely more preferable to the national autodeterminism practiced in past centuries. Richard Cohen of CBS said, we are going to impose our agenda on the coverage by dealing with issues and subjects we choose to deal with. Remember when O.J. Simpson was on the news for almost a year? This was done intentionally to divert our attention away from the fact with what was happening with China being given the port in Los Angeles. Chinagate was going on. They didn't want us to know about that, so they focused our attention on O.J. Simpson. Somebody said he's getting married again. He wants to take another stab at it. Richard Salent, the former president of CBS News, said, our job is to give the people not what they want, but what we decide they ought to have. New York Times is deliberately pitched to the liberal, read that socialist, point of view, said the foreign editor of the New York Times, he ought to know. News reporters are certainly liberal and left of center. Walter Cronkite's one of the best of them, as far as left as you can get, okay? By the way, opposite of right is not left. Opposite of right is wrong. The news media, in general, are liberals. Okay. Number 7, destroy people's faith in their leaders. Lenin, or Stalin, is attributed with this statement. He said, those who cast the votes decide nothing. Those who count the votes decide everything. The last election ought to tell us something about that, right? Number 8, cause the registration of all firearms so that you can eventually confiscate them. Lenin said, one person with a gun can control 100 people without one. Now picture this. You're standing there in the bank to cash a check. Somebody walks in and holds up a gun and says, everybody lay on the floor. Everybody lays on the floor. Now picture this. Every red-blooded, honest, God-fearing American citizen is packing a gun. He's not looking for trouble. He just has a gun, just in case, you know. The guy walks into the bank, pulls out a gun. Everybody lay on the floor. Instantly, 80 guns are pointed at him. No, sir, you lay on the floor. Gun control is not about guns, it's about control. Every dictator has wanted gun control. Lenin wanted it, Stalin wanted it, Hitler wanted it. See, the one who has the gun is in control, and this goes back to the ye shall be as gods. You know, you are the boss. Goes right back to that, folks, okay? Don Boyes, a good friend of mine, said gun control is not about guns, but control. Don said, you might be a liberal if you don't trust honest Americans with automatic weapons, but you do trust the government with them. You might be a liberal if you think guns are the cause of crime, but you don't think matches are the cause of arson. You might be a liberal if you think death penalty is government-sanctioned killing, but you don't think a prison sentence is government-sanctioned kidnapping. I like this guy's thinking, okay? Our founding fathers gave us the Second Amendment, which says, a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. They gave us a Second Amendment so we could protect ourselves in case the government went bad. That's what it's for. See, the bad guys are not afraid of a few hundred people with guns. But if everybody's armed, it's going to be hard to take over a country. If they know everybody's armed. Now, I told you in another session that a lot of animals that eat grass have horns. You don't need horns to eat grass. You need horns as an education tool to educate the lion to stay off your back so you can eat the grass. That's what the horns are for, right? If the lions held a conference to outlaw horns on animals, they said it was dangerous to allow these untrained animals to have such dangerous weapons. They cited several examples where some animals had been accidentally been harmed by horns. You know, I bet if the lions could vote, they would vote that nobody